Hello, everybody. Welcome to the first chapter of the 15 minutes of Dr. Leo Kruinboom. Every Tuesday in English, I hope that I can pursue you to join us in the exploration of such a beautiful science and philosophy, clinical PNI. We really name it normally psycho, neuro, endocrino, socio, immunology. But the thing is, it's a long name, and that normally doesn't prime in the brain of human beings. So clinical PNI is more than enough. And those 15 minutes, they will explore the world, our organs, our cellular functions. We will talk about quantum biology. We will definitely talk about the interaction between human beings and the society. And that's why we talk about neurology, endocrinology, sociology, immunology, psychology, obviously. Yeah. And our idea is that every Tuesday it will also be a little bit fun. Fun is very healthy for a human being. We should laugh a bit. And so once in a while, I will invite a guest. We have some interviews, and it will not always be 100% serious, but it will definitely always be evidence-based medicine. Because that is what we're going to do today. For instance, we're going to talk about, which is logical, the first chapter, the coronavirus, in a way in which we think it's time to open up the eyes, the ears of the world, and look at this pandemia with some new eyes. Because what is happening is that we are completely gambling on a vaccine, which is a good thing. A lot of people, they are afraid of the vaccines against COVID-19. They shouldn't. The success rate is very high if you compare that with the flu vaccine every year, which only has a success rate from 40 to 60%. So, dear people, 90% is fantastic. Don't worry about that. That is not the problem. The problem is, although we are vaccinating, the number of infected people still keep increasing. With all the measurements, with the lockdown. And so we have to look not only to the virus, to the intermediate animal, which could be a rabbit, which could be a velvet. We should, first of all, we should look to human beings and why are we so susceptible to develop this virus. And I will show evidence that there is quite a lot to do to protect us against overall infections, and especially against viral infections. So join me on the first journey in clinical PNI related with this virus, which is a big burden worldwide. Okay, but let's see if we can do something about it. One of the big meta models in clinical PNI is the fact that we were the first 33 years ago to not only think in photomedicine, but also in film medicine. By drawing the photo, you can develop the film, which is incredibly important, because if we only look to the photo of diseases, we will never find out why there is something like an incubation time, why some diseases need 40, 50 years to develop. And if then the disease breakout is there, it doesn't mean that photo is presenting the solution of the disease. So if we look to the film of COVID-19, you see a few very important factors, yeah, which are preventable at one side. And the second thing is that we can protect us against an enormous amount of risk factors, which makes us susceptible for overall infections in COVID-19. Yeah. And one of those things, obviously, is what you see here, yeah, modern life. So we know that the most common symptoms, fever, dry cough, tiredness, they are not alarming symptoms, and not even diarrhea, but when things like difficulty of breathing, shortness of breath, those symptoms, they are really alarming symptoms. But if you look to all the symptoms, you can easily conclude that the virus is capable of producing lung disease, gut disease, brain disease, kidney disease, and heart disease. And that means that the virus has the capability of infiltrating an enormous amount of tissues and organs, and therefore there has to be a logical reason. That goes further than, as you see here in the film, the presence of hyperexpression of entry molecules like AC2, everybody knows that, the proteases TMPR, SS2, and furin. No, there has to be more behind this pandemic. And if you look to the most important risk factor for the development of COVID-19, it's the presence of adipose tissue all over the place. And that is what is happening with us, with Homo sapiens here. Our sedentary lifestyle, our high calorie diets, a lot of chronic stress, and in the lack of, we will see, climatological challenges makes us fat. It's not even necessary to be overweight. It's about something which is called ectopic fat. Fat in visceral organs like the liver, like the heart, like the head. All organs can develop a fatty state. And fat cells are homing cells for this virus. You know why? Because it finds a perfect environment to reproduce, and in not like sexual reproduction, no, to multiply itself, because in those cells, like in thrombocytes, and like in cells with a very, very poor metabolism, such as in people with a sedentary lifestyle, the virus finds an anaerobic environment where glycolysis is active, and that means that glucose is a kind of fermented, which means amino acids are produced, nucleotides are produced, and those nucleotides are necessary for the building of new mRNA molecules, which the virus needs to multiply itself. So we see it is not really overweight, it is really the accumulation of fat tissue in different organs, for instance, the liver. You see here, people suffering from a non-alcoholic fatty liver disease have, without overweight, have 220% more susceptibility for the development of COVID-19. And we are now 1 year ahead. So that means epidemiology is advancing, is progressing. And we now have a whole series of diseases related with a higher susceptibility for the development of COVID-19. You see, important examples are type 2 diabetes and immunocompromised states like people in chemotherapy and cancer, people using cortisol all the time, obesity, and another series of diseases, yeah, which is also associated with a higher susceptibility, but with less evidence. But when I look to these diseases, diseases cannot be a risk factor. Diseases are diseases, yeah, which are caused by risk factors. And if we look to the risk factors of all these diseases, we see, yeah, that is high calorie food, lack of exercise, sedentary life, smoking, pollution, light pollution, environmental pollution, social defeat, so loneliness, and those risk factors are risk factors for these diseases. These diseases are risk factors. That is what is in the scientific literature for the susceptibility of COVID-19. So that means that's the rule of three, that these risk factors have to be risk factors for the development of COVID-19. But as you see, it is weird that normothermia or the lack of challenges or pesticides can really be risk factors for disease. On the other hand, we should look then to why human beings became so fragile. And if we see where human beings come from, they come from surviving and reproducing in a non-benign environment. An environment with hunger, with thirst, with cold, with heat. And you know, that made us strong. And definitely Homo sapiens from nowadays in Europe is not at all Homo sapiens like he or she was as we were before. Today in anthropology, we can really redefine European humans, and we call them Homo fragile. Yeah? And you see the absence of all kind of non-benign stimuli like cold, like heat, like intermittent hunger. Those are so beautiful, yeah, and so necessary for us, yeah, that we could really increase our strength, our defense against this corona disease, the SARS-CoV-2. Okay, so those risk factors, the absence of those non-benign triggers, are also risk factors as the other on the left-hand side, like smoking, etc. So if you look and compare us, Homo sapiens, with wild plants and wild animals, then you see an incredible, interesting comparison possibility. Look, why people eat, what's the big difference between organic fruit and non-organic food, or wild animals or domestic animals? It is based on that organic animals, wild animals, organic plants, wild plants, are much better protected against all kinds of infections, which is logical because they have to defend themselves. And that is one of the reasons that the Homo sapiens is not organic anymore. And we are not biological dynamic, biodynamic food, fantastic, yeah, full with substances which protects the plant, protects the animal against infections. The same substances we can produce, things like lactoferrin, a lot of substances with which we could protect us against a lot of pathogens. But the problem is, we are not organic anymore. We are sick intoxicated, fragile people, yeah, with pesticides, with their insecticides, with medicines, and with a lack of chances. And those chances, yeah, could recover our defense against a lot of pathogens, a lot of pathogens. As you see here, a cold shower every day, starting with 30 seconds 1 week, then 60 seconds the second week, and in 2 weeks, 90 seconds, could protect us, yeah, against absence because of disease for 29%. Regular sauna use with some exercise, maintaining VO2 max over 30 milliliters, which is not much at all, adds a protection against pneumonia with 38%. If you fast intermittently, incredible but true, your nasopharyngeal space will be better protected with all kinds of molecules, glycans, preventing the entrance of virus and other pathogens. The same holds for the use of acute known stress triggers like cold, heat, intermittent hunger, intermittent thirst, because what does it do? What does it do? It brings your immune system to the outside of your body. It brings it to the barriers, which means that it is much more difficult that a virus, a pathogen, enters the human body. And if it enters, what we need is a very fast, effective response of the immune system, antibodies. And you see, if we offer non-benign known triggers to human beings, then antibody production is very much accelerated. That's protection against severe COVID-19. And that's why, yeah, we have investigated a project which is called intermittent living, eye living, with eye fasting, with eye drinking, with eye hypoxia, with eye cold, with eye heat, all triggers combined, which makes people anti-fragile. And we have already investigated more than 400 different people, patients and clients, ill and healthy people. Yeah? And we've seen that they are significantly less susceptible for being infected, but more important, to develop severe COVID-19. So this is where I would like to stop today. The first 50 minutes of Dr. Leo Pruimboom in four languages. This is English. The first one will also be in Dutch, Spanish, and in German, to open up and to persuade the whole body to follow us every Tuesday in the 15 minutes of Leo Pruimboom. Thank you very much.